with me this morning. Don't ask me any hard questions. I'll take notes and I'll answer you by email. When the thickness has drifted away. No hard questions.
Don't ask any either.
Okay. All right. If I do, I'll catch myself and I'll give you the answer and you can pencil it down. We're going to begin with Luther's morning prayer, and if you know it and you'd like to pray it aloud along with us, please feel free. In the name of the Father, and the Son, and the Holy Spirit, amen. I thank you, my Heavenly Father, through Jesus Christ, your dear Son, that you have kept me this night from all harm and danger. Keep me this day also from sin and every evil, that all my doings and life may please you. Into your hands I commend my body and soul and all things. Let your holy angel be with me, that the wicked foe may have no power over me. Amen. Okay, so we're done with lesson 4. And at popular request, we're going to do a little review of Fellowship Light. And all the people that asked me to do a review of Fellowship Light are still en route or trying to warm up their cars. So we'll see what happens. We have one more lesson left in this Augsburg Confession, and the next one we probably will get started on it today, is on the Formula Concord. We have today, and we have two more Sundays in December left, and then in January I pass it back off to Pastor Thompson for his next topic, which I'm not sure what it is just yet. But my question of you is, if I were to give you the option of, do we meet next week, Sunday morning, Christmas Eve, Sunday morning service for Bible class, yay or nay, what do you say?
Yay.
You say yay? Mm-hmm. I mean, I'll be here. I have no problems in showing up. Okay, good. All right, then I'll be here. I'll be here next Sunday, 9 o'clock, and we'll continue on. And if we end up with finishing up lesson 5, and I still have that one Sunday in December, we could maybe take a deeper look into some of the fellowship issues if there's anything that comes up today. We'll see how it goes. Who knows? We might end up the whole day on this Fellowship Light. So, all right, I'm going to give you just a brief review of what you learned in catechism class about fellowship. And you've got a little handout. One is just going to be the basics, just to kind of show you where the doctrine comes from. And then the second part is going to kind of look at where the rubber hits the road when it comes to fellowship primarily, and that's in the area of prayer fellowship. So if you'll look at it with me, I'll just kind of walk you through it. Fellowship is an expression of love. It's a love for God, love for His Word, love for your soul, and love for the souls of other people. That's really the prompting, motivating reason behind the doctrine of fellowship, other than the fact that the Bible teaches it. Okay, so if you can kind of get that into your head, that this is not a separatist, sectarian, keep us barricaded away from the ungodly heretics of the other denominations of Christendom, that's not the goal of fellowship. It's our love for God, love for His Word, love for your soul, the health of your soul, but it's also for the love of the health of the soul of the individual that you're talking to that has what? A different understanding of what Scripture says or what they have been taught. Okay? The love is the motivating force behind this. And ultimately, at the end of the day, you have to ask yourself the question, who do I love more? My Savior or this person that I'm dealing with? And as much as you care about that person, whether it's a son or a daughter or maybe even a spouse or a brother or a parent, ultimately at the end of the day, you got to say that you love your Savior Jesus more than anything else. Love Jesus number one. Yeah? Okay, let's take a look at it. Christian fellowship can be described in two different ways. Our relationship with God may at times also refer to an invisible church fellowship. Christian fellowship is really our relationship with God and our relationship, just like in Lord's Supper. The vertical relationship that we have with our Savior coming to us, like in the sacrament of baptism, the sacrament of Holy Communion especially is where you see it. And then there's Christian fellowship on a horizontal plane. And everybody that comes to that communion rail is supposed to be all on the same doctrinal page, okay? Maybe not as deep in their understanding of spiritual truths, or as we say, strong faith, weak faith, which is not a term that I like to use because it's not really used in the Bible, okay? Although we all know what people mean by that. If you have a strong faith, it means that somehow the word has built up in a sedimentary layer and it's given you an ability to be able to weather the storms of the stresses and tensions of life a wee bit better than supposedly a person who has weak faith. The bottom line is that when you're on your deathbed, how much faith do you need to have in order to get into heaven? As small as a mustard seed. Right? Okay. Church fellowship is that activity that members have with invisible churches. So we all come down here as brothers and sisters in Christ after church, and we have what?
Fellowship.
And we have coffee together, and we console one another, and we listen to one another's problems, and we find out that they've got enough money to be able to see them through to the end of the month, all that kind of stuff. That's church fellowship. Okay, fellowship in Scripture. It's spoken of heavily and woven throughout virtually the entire New Testament. But you have three major areas where you see the doctrine of fellowship being spoken about. And I've got them listed there for you so that you can actually take this home and dig into it this week, excuse me, on your own or with your spouse as a devotional tool. John's letters. In 1 John 4 and 2 John particularly, it's presented negatively. And negatively we mean that it's not a bad thing. Negatively and positively are philosophical terms that the church has adopted, all right? When you say that something is stated negatively, you're stating what it is not, or what it is, it translates as what we're against, okay? Stated positively, primarily in 3 John, all right? So you'll notice the difference. If you just want to start on Monday and take a look at 2 John and 3 John, you'll see the difference between negatively stated and positively stated, okay? Also in Revelation letters, warning against false doctrine, encouragement to persevere in the truth, and primarily in Paul's pastoral epistles, okay? The motivation and the goal in fighting false doctrine is love. Ultimately, at the end of the day, again, I state, you love Jesus, number one, but how much do you really want to put into the effort of showing the love for the soul that has an erroneous understanding of what Scripture says? Because why is that important? That's a hard question I just asked. Now I have to answer it, because Doug's not ready to answer that question yet. Why is that important? Because how does the Holy Spirit promise that He's going to deal with you? That's a simple question. Only through His Word. Only through His means of grace. Has He promised that He's going to strengthen you, create faith, strengthen your faith, preserve your faith? Okay? So if the Bible is the means by which God fuels your faith and strengthens your faith and feeds your faith, if it's like a giant pipe, a 10-inch pipe, why would you do anything to start whittling away from the flow of that pipe through false error and false doctrine? Okay? Because the Holy Spirit does not work through false doctrine. That's not the means of grace. That's not the purity of His Word. So that's why it's so dangerous when a church body starts down the slippery slope, because the 10-inch main or the 12-inch main is slowly, slowly, slowly getting narrowed and narrowed and narrowed until you get to the point where you look at some church bodies who call themselves Christian and you wonder, is the Holy Spirit still even there? Now that's a judgment call for God. Okay, just like we can't judge the hearts of a person, all we can do is go by the confession of their mouth. But God knows, and it causes one to wonder, is the Holy Spirit at work in some denominations when they deny the virgin birth, when they deny a bodily resurrection, when they deny the real presence of the body and blood in with and under the bread and wine of the sacrament, when they deny that baptism is nothing more than an initiation rite into the Christian faith, that it does not create faith. When you take all of those basic truths and tenets of the Bible away, is the Holy Spirit still working amongst those people? God, you pray He is, but you honestly wonder, That's why it's so important. Okay, let's take a look at it. We have adopted this phrase within our church body called the unit concept of fellowship. Okay? And we look at all the doctrines and on the topic of fellowship. And we apply them both to altar fellowship, Lord's Supper, pulpit fellowship, who do we allow or permit to preach in our pulpits and feed our flocks, right? But also in the area of prayer fellowship. We do not make a distinction between the three because Scripture does not make a distinction between the three. And for those of you who are going to watch this on YouTube and think that I'm throwing stones at other church bodies, I'm not. But Missouri Synod, Lutheran Church Canada, has found a way, or seems to have a way, that in practice, prayer fellowship, prayer is not worship. And so it's different and separate issue from altar and pulpit fellowship. Okay? So in the area of altar and pulpit fellowship, theoretically, in paper, they're on the same page as the Wells. But when it comes to prayer, they don't consider that as worship. And we'll look at that a little bit more in the next two pages. Okay? So this unit concept is basically broken down to all doctrines and all expressions of fellowship. And I've got just a smattering there. All doctrines, just look through it with me, for just let your eyes dance over that. The practice of church fellowship must be based on agreement in all the doctrines of Scripture. Matthew, teaching them to obey everything I have commanded you. John 8, if you hold to my teaching, you are truly my disciples. Acts 20, for I have not hesitated to proclaim to you the whole will of God. Romans 15, a spirit of unity. Agree with one another, perfectly united in mind and thought. Not partially united in mind and thought. Right? Sound instruction from Timothy, speaking the very words of God from Peter. Revelation, he's taught warning there at the end of chapter 22. If anyone takes away from the words of this book or adds to the words of this book, judgment upon them. The apostles' concern for doctrinal purity was not limited to a few key doctrines. It covers the whole gamut. And there I've got some more Bible study material for you at home. You can take a look at those verses. But it's also in all expressions of this doctrine. The various activities through which we express church fellowship must be dealt with as a unit. Colossians speaks about in the area of worship. Corinthians 10, Lord's Supper. Philippians, financial support, because of your partnership in the gospel from the first day until now. And I'm just going to take a moment and talk about that for just a second. Karen, I'm wondering if you could do me a favor. Could you go into the kitchen, open up the right door of the refrigerator, can you grab me a bottle of water, please? Thank you very much. I'll talk very slowly so you don't miss anything. So, in the area of financial support. It's the time of year when there's people out with Santa hats on, with a three-legged stand and a chain holding a kettle, right? With a grate over the top. Mm-hmm. You know who I'm talking about? Mm-hmm. The Salvation Army. And is their cause a great cause to support homeless, to help fire victims, to show up with their emergency vans and have people to have a place to go where it's warm when their house is burned down? Thank you very much. Great cause. Did you know that the Salvation Army is really a church? Yes. Okay. I would give that some thought before you drop $5 in there. If you want to help somebody, give the $5 to Sue or to Maines, and let us put it into the petty cash at St. Paul so that we have some money to be able to go out and buy $10 Loblaws food carts when people come, because our budget gets shrinked on that. We only budget $300 a year to be able to help people from the outside. Did you know that? So if you want to help the homeless, help people who are down and out, trust that your pastors know when it's a true story or a scam story, and we can give us some cash to be able to put in the coffers and you're not supporting another church, you wouldn't walk into a mosque or a Buddhist temple and give them, say, here's $10, would you? To support their ministry? I don't know, would you? Is that a hard question?
No.
I can't answer that one for you. I just asked you a hard question. I can't answer that one for you. Grant.
Do you know with certainty that the money that is raised is used to support not only their charitable acts, but also their actual church body?
According to the last operating statement and brochure that I saw from them 4 or 5 years ago, yes and yes. Now, most of it they try to funnel to their outreach efforts, which would be helping the homeless and operating their emergency vehicle that shows up when there's a fire. But there is a percentage of that that is actually going for administrative costs, which would be essentially supporting their church body. Yeah, that's a good question. So I'm not dissing the Salvation Army. I'm just using it as an example of, you know, when you're thinking that you want to do something good, especially at this time of year, with your donation, think about where that's going, because it's ultimately, at the end of the day, a fellowship issue.
Well, we have humanitarian aid through the wells, too.
We do.
So, and they do an awesome job with very little money. So that's, encourage that as well.
Thanks. And we have, as Wells Canada, we have supported various emergencies through Wells Relief. And the latest one was the floods in Texas. Any amounts of money that the congregations collected, we were able to keep in Canada, so we don't violate CRA regulations. We kept it in Canada, but then we told the Board for Home Missions, just reduce our subsidy by $4,218. And then forward that money over to the relief committee. And that's how we're able to do it. So all the money stayed on the proper side of the border. It was just a ledger, an accounting change, or accounting entry. Getting back to all expressions, if you look at 2 John 10, any kind of support, Galatians, joint work. We have looked at very carefully. We don't do joint mission work with bodies that are not in fellowship with us, because this is ministry. So when any number of Christian organizations send letters to Pastor Thompson and myself, or call up and say, you know, our missionary from Honduras is going to be in Ottawa on the weekend of January 31st. Would you like to have them come and speak to your Bible class and then preach a sermon on missions for your congregation? Well, what church, you know full well, what church body are we with? Well, we're with the Baptist Church, or the Reformed Church, or the Presbyterian Church, or the Methodist Church. We don't have them come and teach our people in Bible class and preach from the pulpit. We also don't enter into mission work with those organizations. We do mission work with those who are in fellowship with us around the world, through the CELC, the Confessional Evangelical Lutheran Conference, all the various national church bodies around the world that are in fellowship with the Wells. Bottom of the page, prayer fellowship. And I have the question for you. Where in Scripture is altar fellowship or pulpit fellowship separated from prayer fellowship? And the answer is not a hard one. The answer is we won't find it. They're always linked and related. So let's take a look at prayer fellowship. This is probably the one that the rubber hits the road for you the most. In a nutshell, before I start, we're taught at the seminary, teach your people the basics of fellowship, the doctrines of fellowship, and then let them micromanage their own life and make the practical applications. And one of the practical applications, it really becomes a dilemma for some of our folks once they understand the doctrine of fellowship, is do I or don't I, can I or can't I pray with my Uncle Joe? This is going to help address that. Let's walk through it. Prayer is always an act of worship. We cannot say this prayer is simply an act of friendship or sociability. Prayer is always a religious act. All prayer, therefore, should be offered in accordance with the biblical principles of fellowship. Let's pause for a moment and get our bearings. The context of Scripture's teaching of fellowship is a warning against false doctrine, an encouragement to persevere in the truth. The goal of fighting false doctrine is love. Thus, fellowship is an expression of love. And you have it again, love for God, love for His Word, love for your soul and the soul of the other person. The basis for fellowship in the visible church is agreement on all that Scripture teaches, thus the unit concept of fellowship practiced by the Wells. The Word of God is the basis for our doctrine, and teach them to obey everything that I have commanded you, Matthew 28. The unit concept of fellowship means that all doctrines of Scripture must be dealt with as an indivisible unit when we are trying to determine with whom we may practice fellowship. A Christian confession of faith is, in principle, always a confession to the entire Word of God. The denial, adulteration, or suppression of any Word of God does not stem from faith, but from unbelief. And you have just a smattering of passages there you can double-check me on. Now back to our topic, flipping over. Praying in the presence of a person is not the same as praying with a person. Paul had no hesitance to pray in the presence of heathen on board the ship in Acts chapter 27, but he did not join their heathen prayers nor ask them to join in his. Simultaneous silent prayer within a group that is not united in doctrine is not an expression of prayer fellowship. Now, that comes up because a few of our members over the years have been in homeschooling groups, and those homeschooling groups morph into just mommy and me get-togethers, and most of them tend to be Christian families, and they might get together to study the Bible, they might get together just to talk about, more often than not, it's to get together to talk about what curriculum can we use for my third grader and my sixth grader. But sometimes those meetings would start with prayer, and the individuals in our congregation would come and say, you know, I'm really feeling uncomfortable about this. What should I do? And I tell them, why don't you just offer to everyone just bows their head and has a silent prayer on their own? That's the way around this little conflict that you seem to have or backed yourself into. So there's one practical application of it. You all just privately have your own little prayer, and then you can move on with the business portion of your meeting. Make sense? Okay, moving on. Praying with a person, however, is always an act of joint worship and therefore an act of fellowship. Seminary professor John Brugge, now retired, in writing a paper of the practical applications of church fellowship states, the one practical difference is that when religious fellowship with family or friends involves only private actions, which will not give public offense, we may consider not only the public confessions which they make through their church membership, but also their private personal confession. Okay, I'll comment on that in a minute. Let me just keep going for a second. So the public confession of the church, which the family member or friend belongs, will govern our fellowship with them in the public arena. In other words, we, like the believers of Acts 2, would not participate in worship or prayer in their church services. In love, we would warn them about the false teaching of the church in which they held membership by not participating with them. But in our private dealing with the family member or friend, we might consider their private personal confession. If they are members of a false teaching church and they object to the teachings, even fighting against it, we would encourage them to fight for the truth, also warning them that the time may come when they will have to reject their church truth. Their private confession to us and their public church membership are in deference and in time would have to be brought into harmony. That may be the easy part, since it seems church membership will be the determining factor if the family member or friend is unaware of the unscriptural beliefs or practices of the church and are not holding to these false teachings. We will want them to become aware of the problems which they may be supporting by their offerings. Okay, there's your primer. Couple practical applications. My grandmother's brother, Uncle Dave, Chinese nickname Pocky. Pocky was a member of the Evangelical Lutheran Church. That's because he grew up in the Swedish Synod called the Augustana Synod, okay? And that merged into Elka. When my grandmother died, we went to the funeral at an Elka church. When my grandfather died, we went to the same Elka church, this time with a female pastor. I was nice. I didn't say a thing. Did I participate in worship? No. Karen and I sat and observed. We didn't stand. We didn't sit. We didn't sing the hymns. We didn't pray the Lord's Prayer. Do you think that's an easy thing for a Christian to go into a Christian environment, a worshipful environment, and not want to participate? That's not an easy thing. Not at all. But we went to observe. That night, because we were staying with Pocky at their house, Dave and Cleo's house, we got into a conversation, Dave did, especially after my grandfather's funeral. He was not happy at all about the fact that his church body had permitted females to be pastors of God's flock. Not happy at all. In fact, I think the words that came out of his mouth was, "My beloved church body is going to hell in a handbasket." And Cleo said, "Oh no, honey, it's been here for a couple of decades." He knew. And I had the conversation with him, and I said, "Dave, I'm not trying to proselytize. I'm not trying to steal sheep, but I think for your own spiritual welfare, this is not the first time we've had this conversation. You seriously need to think about leaving your church body, because your church body has left you and it's left Scripture. And I would invite you to come and check out one of the Wells churches here near St. Louis Park in Minneapolis." Well, he never did. And he emotionally couldn't bring himself to leaving the church body that his father had been a member of. And I get that. Pastor Fultenauer went through the very same thing. Did he not? His father was what? The president of the seminary or the president of the synod? Or his grandfather. His grandfather was the president of the synod. And he had to leave a church body that he had grown up in. That's not an easy thing to do. That night, did I have grace with Dave and Cleo at their dinner table?
Yeah.
I did. First of all, because it's not a public expression, so it's not going to cause any offense, right? I'm not going to have, you know, I wasn't a pastor at the time. There's not going to be members going to say, "What in the heck is Pastor Getzinger doing?" But I also knew by his confession that he was not in fellowship with his church body, not one whit. In fact, he was more in fellowship, Dave and Cleo, with Karen and I. He just hadn't made the official step. And he was strongly contesting the teachings of his church body. Another example. My house, my turf, my temple. I'm the priest there. When you're at my dinner table, we're going to have grace. And if you, as my guest, who are of nothing religion, want to join in, that's your choice. Just like visitors coming to this church to join us for worship. If they want to join in on the prayers, that's wonderful. But when I go to my sister's house for dinner, I do not participate in the prayers around the dinner table, because I know her theological stand. And I'm not in agreement with her, because it's not in agreement with what Scripture says. Last example. Then I'll open it up for questions and we can get on to the Formula Concord or whatever you want to do. Long conversation when I'm in Milwaukee for mission board meetings 5-6 years ago. I've got to give a devotion the next morning at the mission board meeting. My mother keeps me up until 2 o'clock in the morning talking about fellowship. Now, she had been, and my father had been, members of what she loves to call the Loosey Goosey Lutheran Synod. Those are your words, Mom, not mine. ELCA. They don't practice anymore. She says that she still believes that Jesus is her Savior. But we get into talking about, in her words, Wells' peculiar practice of who to worship with and who not to worship with. Okay, the whole night finally culminated in the million-dollar question to me, and she says to me, "Do you mean to say, my son," that's you when you know the Carolee is serious, "do you mean to say, my son, that if I'm on my deathbed over at West Allis Hospital, and I ask you to come and bring me Lord's Supper, does that mean that you're not going to give me Lord's Supper on my deathbed just because I'm not a member of your church body?" What was my answer to her?
Yes.
I would. I would, because it's not a violation of fellowship.
You would give her the Lord's Supper?
Pardon?
You would.
Absolutely. Absolutely. First and foremost, I am called to be a minister of the gospel, not a minister of the law. Right? Second of all, it's not going to cause public offense because it's not public worship. It's private. And you abdicate always on the side of the gospel rather than on the side of the law. Now, does that mean that I'm not going to have the conversation with her, which I did, which is why we went until 2 o'clock in the morning? I said, okay, we need to clear this up in case I get a call from Dad that I've got to fly down here at moment's notice to give you Lord's Supper, because no one in Milwaukee can do it. What do you believe the Lord's Supper is? I mean, I want to make sure that she understands what the Lord's Supper is and what it is not. Right? It's not the Lutheran last rites. It's not the Lutheran extreme unction where I give you your last supper and then I pour oil on your forehead, you know, like the priest does. That's not it at all. But I would. But then I said to her, but having said that, if you ever decide that you're going to come back to Ottawa again, and you come to our church for worship, and it's a Sunday morning where we have Lord's Supper, please don't think that what I just said to you gives you carte blanche to come up to the communion rail and publicly now partake of the Lord's Supper and publicly confess, theoretically confess, your oneness and fellowship with the body of believers that are at the communion rail, because I got to tell you, Mom, at that point, I'm going to put my hand on your head and give you a blessing in good Christian historical fashion, and I'm going to pass you right by, and I'm not going to give you Lord's Supper. And do you understand the distinction between the two? And she said, she said yes. She said she did. Yeah. But the better question is, do you understand the distinction? I'm seeing a lot of heads going like this. Look who's back.
Yeah.
Just for Christmas. Go ahead.
No, I don't. So, because it, or I at least ask, boy, it's awfully like splitting hairs that are really tough to split. So, your example of giving your mother Lord's Supper, if Uncle Joe is in the room, we don't know what Uncle Joe believes.
Yeah.
It just starts to get really weird and
I would
difficult.
Ask Uncle Joe to leave the room.
Okay, so you're in the... But yeah. It still is like...
Yeah.
You know, although when you finished it with, but if she comes here for public, yeah. Oh, okay, I start... Yeah. I was worried about wondering, well, wait a minute, what about yeah. coming to church here? But yeah. One's public, one's private.
One's public and one's private.
But it still seems fundamentally wrong.
If you're
going to give them public, why differentiate that from the private?
Yeah, the private is if you're not giving offense to any of your weaker members of your congregation who might not understand what I just explained. Yeah, I mean, you know, when I came out of the seminary, I was so concerned about upholding the truths of Scripture that I think on this point, I was almost legalistic. At this point, and some incident happened in that first 9 months that I was here, and I just hopped on the phone with John Schutze, Professor Schutze, who was one of the pastoral theology and doctrine guys at the seminary, and And I said, John, you got to walk me through this. I mean, somewhere along the line, I picked up this legalistic trait of, you know, trying to preserve our purity so much and being the shepherd of the flock and, you know, watching over our doctrine and our practice so closely that I think I've turned into a legalist on this one. And that's where he said, you know, I guess maybe I didn't cover it well enough in class, but he said, there is this distinction between the public and the private, and it's not like you're talking out of both sides of your mouth, because he's the one that pointed out to me, he said, Skip, ultimately at the end of the day, we're ministers of the gospel, and you always abdicate on the side of the gospel. We're not Old Testament Pharisees, right? The Old Testament Pharisees had absolutely no exceptions for grace, none. It was all law, right? So that's that, Tom, is the challenge of being a shepherd or being a deacon within a congregation. You're always endeavoring to keep a link between your doctrine and your practice. Because if your practice does not reflect your doctrine, you're a heretic. You're a hypocrite. If your doctrine says, we believe that the Bible teaches that God ordained only men to be shepherds of the flock in order to be pastors. Okay? That's in our official doctrinal stance. But then all of a sudden, we're starting to allow females to become pastors. There's a break there in your consistency between your doctrine and practice. And that happens in any number of places, right? But you're always managing that consistency between the doctrine and the practice very carefully, so that you're doing it in love and evangelically, but you're also maintaining what all of God's counsel has to say on that. And it's not an easy thing to do. Some areas it's very easy. One good example, and I'm not going to give you specifics, but would be in a separation and or leading up to a divorce case, right? We know what our doctrine is about. God says in Malachi, I hate divorce, right? But how you practically apply that to the couple, there's a base starting place is, of course, where you start when you're counseling a couple together or individually, right? But those behind the scenes really know what the dynamics are in any particular given situation. To the people in the second ring of observers on this particular... How come Pastor Thompson dealt with that couple that way and Pastor Getzinger dealt with that couple that way? You know? It seems like they're maybe not on the same page, you know? Well, what you don't know is what we know behind the scenes. And I would encourage you, if that ever happens on any particular topic here at St. Paul, you need to make a beeline for one of our offices, whoever's involved in the case, and say, you know what? I'm not challenging you. And I don't think you're a heretic, and I don't think you're leading us down a slippery slope. But, and I don't mean to stick my nose in where it doesn't belong, and then we'll say, well, good, there's the door, thank you very much. But if you are involved and you're seeing this inconsistency, you need to get that cleared up. You need to come and say, listen, you know what, I'm not getting it, I'm sorry. I'm not saying that you're, like, leading us down an unbiblical path, but it just... something doesn't look and taste and smell and sound right here. Can you explain to me whatever you can about this to help me understand? So I don't know if that helps you, but yeah, it's really the public and the private and this overarching dominant idea that the gospel prevails. And that doesn't mean you take it so far as to gospel reductionism. Gospel reductionism is the gospel always prevails to the point of everything. Jesus is love. Jesus would never preach the law. Jesus is love. Well, but Jesus also was very harsh with the Pharisees. Well, he's Jesus. You're not. You have to love. Yeah, but they just said a heretical statement. Well, we need to love them back into the truth. Well, sometimes the old man also needs the law, right? So, and there's that balance. I remember my dad saying to me, oh man, I was turning into a tough little protector of the truth. And I don't know, I think it was my senior year at the seminary. And he said to me, I made some comment and that he didn't particularly agree with. But he had a point. And he said, you know, Skip, he says, you're old enough to know that life isn't always black and white. It's a million shades of gray. And you need to learn how to sort that out. And I was like, boom! You know, it's just like, whoa, you're absolutely right. God's word is black and white, is it not? Yeah, it is. That was not a hard question. You could have all gone like this. Yeah, God's word is black and white. There is law and there is gospel. There is sin and there is grace. But implying those truths to a million shades of gray to multiple personalities at any given point in their life is not so much a science as it becomes an art. Yeah? All right, what other questions do you have that I can't answer this morning? Kathy?
You know, I agree with you for, like, not wanting to worship publicly with, you know, other faiths. But I'm having a hard time coming to grips of attending a funeral. It could be a relative.
Yeah.
It could be a very, very best friend's mother or father. And if we don't pray with it, I have a hard time not being able to stand. And it's more out of respect than anything, and I don't want anybody else to think, do they think they're any better than us? Because that's sometimes what's going to happen. And I don't want to lose a friendship over it either. Because, you know, especially if they are, for example, Catholic, you know, and we've had many discussions, but I think I'd lose a friendship over it, and I'd have a hard time with that. I don't know what to do.
Let's go back to the beginning and define your involvement in this worship. So you're going to go to the funeral of a friend's mom, let's say, okay? And you get to the church, right? And you've kind of figured out, you know what the Bible teaches about fellowship, right? And you've kind of sort of figured out, how am I going to deal with this? So this is where I teach you the principles. And I'm going to let you micromanage the bus. I'm going to let you drive the bus, okay? So if you're saying, and stop me where I'm presuming too much, if you're saying, well, I can't just sit there, but I'm going to stand and I'm going to sit when the priest or the rabbi says stand or sit, okay? But I'm not going to be singing the hymns. I'm not going to be praying the prayers. I'm going to just respectfully observe. Right? But I'm not going to sit there like a bump on a log. I've done that. There have been times when I've done that. I don't just sit there stoically like the husband of the wife member who just got dragged there and refuses to stand up because I just hate this church thing. Mm-hmm. So I'm just going to show my displeasure to my wife and everybody around me, you know. Right? No, I've done that. When we went to Shlomo's funeral over at his synagogue, over on Prince of Wales over there, you know, in a little triumvirate where there's the Greek Orthodox and the Roman Catholic and the yeah, whatever that temple is called. When it was time to stand, we stood. When it came time to sit, we sat. And, you know, I spent most of my time, when they're actually reading the Hebrew, actually trying to translate it on the fly and figure out what it is they were talking about. Because the interesting thing is, this is a total aside, they didn't translate it for anybody into English who didn't know Hebrew. But anyway, they went through the ritual of it. So if you're saying that, that's fine. I have no problems with that because I've done that.
Okay.
But I know how much of a challenge it is for Christians to go into a space of worship knowing full well that we're not on the same doctrinal page with them. So why is it that we don't worship with them? Maybe we should ask the fundamental question. Why is it that we do not worship with them? They're Christians. Manfred, give it a kick at the can.
Because you're showing outwardly that you agree with all their practices and their form of worship, which is totally against Scripture. And so by you not, showing them that you do everything that they do, is you're giving them, you're A-okay.
Fellowship essentially is an expression of oneness in faith. It's an expression of we are on the same doctrinal page from A to Z, from soup to nuts, right? All doctrines of the Bible. So when I walk into an Elka church for my grandfather's funeral, if I'm going to start worshiping with them, I'm being a hypocrite. Because I'm not on the same doctrinal page with Elka. Not by a long shot. Right? Am I thankful that the gospel is still preached in that church? Absolutely. Am I thankful that the gospel is preached in a Roman Catholic church? Absolutely. In spite of the errors, the Mariolatry, and the worship of the saints, and how they explain justification, right? I'm thankful that there's Christians in that congregation, and in that denomination, and that church body, and I know that we'll see many of them in heaven, but that does not mean that we're on the same doctrinal page, aka also known as, that does not mean that we're in fellowship, right? Because there is not unity, and by worshiping with them, I'm essentially saying, I'm on the same page with you, and there's no way that I am. Tom, just a second, Linda.
See, I struggle with that an awful lot because I feel, I mean, I'll admit it, I have sang hymns. If it was in English, if it was in French, it's different. But I struggle a lot with that because everybody that was there, if I did stand up or sit down, and I said the Lord's Prayer to myself, it was in French because I couldn't say it in French. But if it was in English, they know that I am not United or Presbyterian or whatever. They know, the people there know that and know what church I belong to. And it gives me an opportunity lots of times to talk about it after. So I really do, I'll admit, I really do struggle with that because for me, we had quite a conversation after this on the Sunday because I have to report what I learned in church this week. And for somebody coming here to, say, to our church and who sings the hymns and, but is not Lutheran, but sings the hymns and participates in the service, really could not understand why I could not, if I went to their church, stand up and sit down.
You could stand up and sit down.
But in the past I kind of misread it and felt that I should not stand up or sit down, or anyway, probably misinterpreted. But so there was quite a struggle in, and the people at their church would know that I am not a member of their church. I'm simply going there for a funeral or christening or something.
Yeah.
So I really do struggle with it.
And so I would ask, continue to struggle with it, because it is going to be a struggle in this life. Nowhere does God say that it's going to be an easy thing to be a Christian in the real world.
But
it's easy to be a Christian on paper.
But I don't feel that I am offending. Like, I honestly...
I ask you the question, are you leaving them with the impression then...
No.
..that we're... I haven't asked you the question yet. Are you leaving them with the impression that we're all Christians are just one big happy family and doctrinal differences don't matter?
No.
How do you know?
I know it for a fact.
Have they said that to you?
They have.
I explained that with them.
Like, I've already explained what I believe, because these are people that I know.
Right.
So they already know what I believe, because we've had these conversations before. Just happens that maybe, say my best friend, she already knows what I believe and, sort of everything about the Lutheran Church.
Mm-hmm.
So, if I'm going to a christening of one of her children,
mm-hmm.
she already knows I am going because I am invited.
So, what's your involvement in the worship then?
I would probably stand up and sit down, and if it was the Lord's Prayer in English, I probably would have said it out loud. If it was in French, I would have said it in my own mind.
Yeah, it sounds like you've micromanaged this thing for yourself just fine. You're not participating in worship other than standing and sitting and then just observing the rest of it, and you might say the Lord's Prayer to yourself inside.
Yes. And I also pray, too, that people, the minister or the priest or whoever it is, that people that would maybe come to the knowledge of the faith just by being there or hearing something, or God would send the Holy Spirit into their heart, because it's a perfect opportunity
that's going to happen through you being there?
Yeah, like, no, not through me. I pray that the Holy Spirit will work in the hearts of the people that are there, especially those who do not know you, and may they come to the knowledge of you because of something.
By virtue of the fact that they're at that worship.
Well, yeah, maybe the Lord would send the Holy Spirit.
If the gospel is preached, if the means of grace are being used, sure. Yeah, that's
also
a good prayer.
Pray that.
What does that have to do with you being there, though?
Well,
I'm pushing you on this because I want you and everybody else to think this through for themselves. I'm not challenging you. I'm not challenging you. I'm just pushing you to think this through for yourself. You gotta. So if you're going,
yeah.
Linda, and you're standing up and you're sitting down and you're not doing anything else and you're just observing,
yeah.
As your pastor, I would say I'm comfortable with that.
And what about singing the hymn if it was a hymn that we even sing?
Then you're worshiping.
Okay, so I'll ask you this one. I had an uncle who died not too long ago. He was Catholic. And my family doesn't go to church. So I asked that I would be able to, I'm not using the right word, not prepare his funeral, but could I suggest a reading, and could I suggest in the sermon it not be all about him, but about, you know, the true faith? Could I choose some of the hymns? Because it, and I wanted him to have a Christian funeral, and for people there maybe who are not going, maybe some the Lord would use that. Was I wrong? And the priest did.
Not from what you're telling me.
Like the priest did use the reading that
that's
I
not,
had.
That's
asked.
Not worship.
That's not
that's,
worship.
No, that's not worship. That's being asked to be the worship planner.
So that's not wrong.
No. No.
It's good, but
no.
Did the uncle go to church?
Yes, he was a Christian.
Why didn't the priest put the worship?
Because it wasn't in the same.
But that's just
it wasn't in the same town.
Well, okay, all right.
No,
your conscience is fine. Tom, you've been waiting.
Well, it's the same sort of scenario. So I'll go back to the funeral, the Catholic funeral for a friend. And so, in my micromanaging of that event, I'm not there to worship with them, and I understand that. But we'll get to the. Whether somebody thinks I might or might not be, but I'm not there. I'm there out of respect for a family member or a friend.
Yeah.
That's what I'm there.
Okay.
If it's in a Christian environment, not necessarily Wells, but a Christian environment, I certainly won't participate in communion. I know that. But I would say the Lord's Prayer out loud, and I probably would sing Amazing Grace if it was sung.
Oh, not Amazing Grace. There's so many other better funeral hymns.
Okay, horribly,
sorry.
Whatever.
Sorry, go ahead. Yeah, I need your point.
And I guess the sense that someone might think that I'm worshiping with them and therefore I might create some sense of that, that's a black and white mentality in my mind and just doesn't recognize except the layers of gray that exist. I can't control everything.
No, you can't.
And you can always do so. That's just too black and white. I kind of thing. So that's kind of where I'm at. I mean, I'm trying to micromanage the scenario, but again, fundamentally, I'm not there to worship with them. And if somebody thinks I am, well, that's not. I know I might be doing something that might give that sense, but
ultimately, I mean, I'm speaking pastorally, and I would hope everybody. Yeah, I think you always need to be concerned about how your words and actions are going to be read by others. So, I mean, if that's a black and white statement, so be it. And understanding you can't control how other people are going to take. You know, I mean, I can preach a sermon this morning, and it's going to be understood 12 different ways because of varying attention levels or my communication ability this morning to the fog of the flu or, you know, whatever. I mean, so, yeah, I'm not going to, like, I'm just going to give you the principles, right? And if when people have, like, Pastor, I did this, was this wrong? You give me a call, you drop me an email, or Pastor Thompson, if you feel more comfortable with it. Yeah, you talk it through, yeah? There was another hand up back there somewhere. Rose.
Just interesting as we chat about this. Last year, my mother-in-law tragically died in the Jehovah's Witness faith, and we were devastated. So we went to the funeral, and obviously we're not planning to participate. But interestingly enough, they did nothing to facilitate us participating. There was no papers There was no hymnals, there was no agenda, there was nothing on the screen, there was nothing on the walls. And obviously we didn't want to participate because we were devastated, but it was very interesting now that we have this discussion that they were really doing nothing to allude that we were in fellowship with them.
Oh.
So I just thought that I'd share that. Quite interesting.
Yeah. That is interesting. Other hands? Carl?
I was thinking I could ask you the same kind of questions about funerals that are coming up in my life. But I suppose the best thing to do is to talk to the people involved and not get caught flat-footed. The people
right.
who know me won't think anything of. I guess I can't be so worried about what other people are going to think depend on my, of my actions, because A, if they don't understand, they don't know who I am, so it doesn't much matter to me.
Right.
I don't think I would create an offense. I'm not saying I'm going to go there and try not to create, specifically to look like I'm worshiping with them, because I won't be able to. But for the people who do know me, they'll understand it, but it's not that my action or not inaction is not meant to offend them. But so many of these things.
And you bring up a really good point that kind of popped up about 10, 15 minutes ago that I was going to say. It's not always an either or. It can be a both and. If you have the conversation with the people that you're going to respect or the people that you love, and you say, here's where I'm coming from. This is what I believe that the Bible teaches me. And when you see me not participating in worship, I'm going to respectfully stand and sit. I'm not dissing your dad, right? But I am coming to show respect for you. And you have that conversation with those folks ahead of time. Time permitting. I mean, if someone has just experienced a devastating loss, like their husband was here yesterday and now all of a sudden, maybe you don't have that conversation with the bride, but you have it at some point. I think having a conversation with these, we so often, people come to me and they say, well, what do you think we should do about so-and-so? Or this and that. I don't know. Here's a novel idea. You, as a Christian brother, go and talk to them and find out. What an idea. You just communicate. So, other hands, I think I'm down to 2 minutes. 1 minute.
Quick, big. I've been asked to do a eulogy at my brother's funeral. My brother's a Catholic who goes to church probably only for funerals. And I've made the mistake in the past of standing up during a service and reading a scripture that was presented by the priest for me to read. And I realized after that was a mistake as I got further in my knowledge of being a Lutheran.
Yeah.
And now I don't want to make the same mistake again. So how do I do it right? Like, I want to give my brother a eulogy, but I don't want other people there to believe that I'm a Catholic.
I guess my knee-jerk response in the last 40 seconds of class is if the eulogy is in the worship environment, I'd say I wouldn't feel real comfortable with that. Eulogy is at some fellowship gathering where you're eating triangle sandwiches, filled with cream cheese and maraschino cherries, that's not a worship environment. That's just sharing as a brother your memories and thoughts about your dearly departed brother. That's not worship.
That's where I was hoping to go.
Any other last minute questions? We can continue next week on this same topic if you want to. But all right, so I'll be here at 9 o'clock next week to have Bible class, and then we'll have Christmas Eve Sunday morning worship at 10:15. Thanks for your good questions. We'll see you later.
See you in worship.